to make an appearance on the screen. Well, I work with living technology, and I'm not an architect. I was actually trained as a medical doctor, and I've made the very logical decision that my field of research is actually more appropriate in the built environment than in medicine, and you'll start understanding why that might be. What I consider myself to be doing is actually designing environmental pharmaceuticals, in other words, agents that can remediate chemical imbalances in the environment, as opposed to the way we traditionally think about them as being the exclusive realm of the human body. Obviously, if you don't have a condition, then you don't need the medicines. It's the same for the environment as it is for the human body. So according to Mr. Blainville, who usually is trustworthy, one can predict that in less than 100 years, will Venice be totally united with the rest of Italy? And you can walk dry shod from Italy to the city. 1771. What we're really bad at is predicting the future. What we're really good at is somehow surviving it. And when I say we, I mean life as we know it on Earth. Scientists like Paul Davis now think that life itself was extinguished many, many, many times from asteroid showers before it finally established itself 4.5 billion years ago. And it's still going. Yet the environment on Earth is not kind. Any structure on its surface that persists requires an awful lot of energy to keep it in some form of homeostasis. After all, in nature, even mountains are moved. So what makes life so resilient? Well, that's a very good question. It's very debatable. I personally think it's got something to do with embodiment, its robustness and flexibility. And what these manage to do somehow is confer this system with the ability to respond in real time to environmental changes. And therefore, it maintains its contingency in its surroundings. Now, obviously, associated with this strategy is a lot of drop-off. So there are mass extinctions. Many organisms die. But actually, that is part of life's strategy. And it's a totally different kind of strategy to other persistent systems. Take, for example, the city of Venice itself, which is in northern Italy, situated on the shores of a lagoon, on the Adriatic Sea. And Venice seems to stand, seemingly, in defiance of all the elements and the climate and the changing forces of nature. And it does so, not by its living properties, but by allying itself with technologies that are the latest of the epoch in which the city has a symbiotic relationship with humans. And I do know that I'm personifying quite dramatically here, but this is in order to make my point. So at the time that the city-state of Venice was being founded, between the 9th and the 12th century, the dominant technologies were agrarian, in other words, land drainage, the creation of canals, and the use of wood piles to shore up the foundations of the developing settlement. And these actually form a really important feature of the city today. But with the industrial era, we have a new set of technologies, ones that bring great power and wealth, although through the excessive use of energy in order to create a top-down atomic scale control mechanism through which matter is subordinated. And this comes at a huge environmental cost. Here, for example, is Marghera. This is an industrial park just north of the city of Venice on the mainland. This is where I sometimes work in a laboratory investigating the technologies of life. This laboratory in this rather interesting tower, it looks incredibly industrial, is situated actually between an oil refinery and a shipbuilding yard that builds ocean liners. So leaving the laboratory in the evening, one is met by the rather surreal spectacle of towers that are burning and buildings that appear to be moving. And because of the environmental impact of the industrial era and its technologies, it is perhaps not surprising then that environmentalists are objecting to an industrial scale solution to the aqua alta, the high tides that are now besetting the city of Venice so much more frequently over the last century. This is some graffiti objecting to the installation of the Moses Project, a series of 78 mechanical gates designed to stop the tide rising and spilling over into the city itself, reminiscent perhaps of the Danish king Canute, who dared the tide to stop and stay away from his realm. But this is a serious problem. The tides, like nature and the environment, are not benign. Walking along the canals in Venice, one sees beautiful buildings that are really being digested away by the elements. You can start to see these classic scars caused by environmental impact. And interestingly, it's at the shoreline that the greatest damage is done. It is not so much the wood piles that are constantly submerged under the water that are actually preserved by the saline, but those that become exposed by the changing levels of the tide that are most damaged. Here is the classic signs of efflorescence, the white dusting on the brickwork, which is the chemical concentration of salt crystals that literally act like the contents of our stomach around a donut, literally turning it into its constituent molecules. And the city inhabitants are quite desperate about doing something about the gradual digestion of their city. As you walk around and put your hands in cannonball-sized holes in the walls, one can find acts of architectural desperation, like lumps of concrete, rubbish, rubble, sand, chewing gum. Ew. So is it all over for Venice? Should we believe the doom-mongers and those people that just say that we should really just vacate the city of Venice, that its survival is something that will be consistent with the stories of the city of Atlantis and other cities that have been reclaimed by the sea? I believe not. I believe there is hope. And there's hope in a very odd place. In the east of the city of Venice is a public gardens, and underneath a strange oak tree in those gardens is another canopy. This oak tree is no ordinary oak tree, of course it wouldn't be. It's situated in the middle of a building designed like a nautilus, which is a banded shelled mollusk that's rather squid-like, designed by the architect Enrico Perissuti. And underneath the natural canopy of the oak tree that's in the middle of the twisty building is another canopy, an artificial canopy. And you can see the feathery fronds of this canopy just underneath the oak leaf's foliage. Let's go closer. This is Hylozoic ground. This is an installation, a collaborative architectural work by architect Philip Beasley, technologist Rob Gorbe, and myself. And essentially, this is a cybernetic installation modeling the earth, the air, and life within it. And Beasley's frond-like complex architectural forms respond to changes in the air, to the breadth and proximity of human inhabitants and visitors. And Rob's cybernetic system manages the information gathered by these sensors and by these mechanisms that are relating to change within this space, and converting them then into effectors, into actions that are then meaningful, So in this particular installation here, we actually have frond-like tongues that actually lift and lick people as they approach. You'll also see various LEDs which communicate with each other as people move through the gallery space. And in the center there, you'll see giant swallowing tubes which pulsate through hydraulic mechanisms. And all of this is an integrated environment. But let's go closer into the foliage of this artificial installation. We start seeing some chemistries which I designed that have living-like properties. This is one of the kinds of fruits. This is a self-evolving chemical precipitation diffusion reaction. It means pretty patterns that look like fractals. And it's in an arrangement that shows the change of these chemicals with time. But here's the one that I want you to focus on. And we'll go in and zoom in a little. This golden orb seems to contain some chemistries or some little black opacities in the middle there. Let's see what's in those. Well, as you can see from the side, they're actually blobs of chemistries that are actually interacting with each other. And actually, it's a very, 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 very simple system. And yet, it's incredibly complex. What's in it is extra virgin olive oil, some water, and some inorganic salts. Let's go further still. Why is that exciting? Well, there's a picture of it absorbing energy, which facilitates the chemistry with time and with passage of the people through the space. So the chemistry and the cybernetic installation are all connected. And here we are going closer still. Each of these has a personality. Now, what you'll see from this movie is that when I haven't made them very, very still, which is what I did for the installation, so they'll last for 3 months, is that this oil and water droplet system, despite not possessing any DNA, is incredibly dynamic. In fact, it possesses properties that can only really be described as living. These droplets are able to move around their environment, sense it, respond to the presence of other protocells, or these little primitive cellular agents, and undergo complex reactions like the shedding of skins or the creation of shells, as well as undergoing population scale kind of behaviors, which result in extremely complex phenomena. And I have movies of those, but I'm not going to show them to you. So essentially what you're witnessing here is the birth, literally quite physically, this amniotic sac, a form of salt that's been created by the interaction of the surface of the oil droplet with the watery surroundings. And this droplet is responding vigorously to its environment by creating this skin of crystals, very, very soft crystals, and it wriggles its way out of its birthing sac and becomes free into the environment. Now, what's so exciting about this particular kind of technology? Well, I believe that this is the very first technology that is genuinely complex. It doesn't behave according to the control systems that we would normally associate with, say, for example, industrial technologies, machines or digital computers. There's no on button, there's no off button, and it's extremely sensitive to its environment. Although I don't have the film here, those agents that have been created in similar environments can detect the tiniest disturbances, say, for example, traces left by their neighbors. And just like humans, these protocells don't like their own waste and they try and move away from it. So if another protocell has crossed the path of one protocell, it actually goes, ew, and it kind of turns a sharp right-hand corner and moves away from the waste products. So they really do have incredible lifelike properties. But not only that, I mean, that's just the hardware. I consider this oil and water droplet system as being a form of programmable hardware. And why am I talking about programming? Because if we actually use the body of the oil droplet as a container for the slow release of other chemistries, we can now start to distribute matter in time and space, and that starts to change the engagement of the technology with the environment entirely. So what you're looking at is another kind of fruit within this cybernetic canopy. And what you see is that there's a little green precipitate around an agent that is actively extracting carbon dioxide that's been dissolved in the solution, which has got into it through the breath of visitors that have inhabited the city, inhabited the installation space, and also we've actually used Venice water in there, so it's been dissolved into lagoon waters from which we've drawn the source of water. And so gradually it's making this carbon dioxide visible and also precipitating it out from its context. So how can we use this? Well, I've created a set of protosalt populations that can actually use carbon dioxide and turn it into a form of paint that can repair brick fragments. You can see these protosols now moving around some Venice brick fragments and creating white scars of brickwork. Not only to bridge the gap between the damaged bricks, but also to create a protective layer around it. So now we're starting to grow a limestone shell. Let me quickly show you a speculative proposition as to how we'd use this in a full-scale Venice. Would introduce protocells into the lagoon waters, which would be programmed to move away from the light. We know we can do that. We also know that they can deposit substances like carbonates, which essentially is the same kind of stuff as carbonate. So then with time, these protocell populations make their way to the darkened foundations where they're energetically at a lower level and start to precipitate their limestone-like structures around the wood piles. And effectively, this offloads the point load of the city. So it's currently standing on stilettos on soft delta soils. If we spread that point load over platforms, which is what we're doing here, then we can effectively stop the sinking of Venice, or at least attenuate it in some way. And of course, the whole issue of sustainability and environment in Venice is an incredibly complex problem to solve. But this is one approach that may help attenuate some of the kinds of stresses that not just Venice, but other cities challenged by changing water levels may face. And this is a future Venice scenario, which kind of looks like a back to the future, a retro future. We can also program these protocells to, for example, become a paint to absorb carbon dioxide and other pollutants around future cities. We can also use them as the basis of a next generation solar cell that doesn't produce electricity, but biofuel. And so essentially, because these are the technologies of life, life being ubiquitous, these technologies have an application and a scope that won't prioritize, or at least won't marginalize developing countries. All countries have their own oil and water and inorganic salts available to them very, very locally. And ideally, the idea would be to release an effective recipe using mobile SMS messages and get people to encourage them to develop these technologies within their own environments, in their own niche applications. And so essentially, living technology is important because, going back to the beginning, the most effective survival mechanism that we know on the planet is life itself. Now, what if our cities could engage with those processes as well as the industrial and the digital and agrarian processes and technologies that we already know? And so living technology is unique in the sense that it offers a way forward in this age of environmental and architectural uncertainty by not pretending to know the future, but by being able to respond in real time to immediate changes in the environment and therefore persist, just like life itself does. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I was asked to speak today after a story I wrote in the February issue of Fast Company investigated the notion of smarter cities. You can find this online, I think, on the conference website and Fast Company's website. But You know, the notion of smarter cities has been around for a very long time, at least 20 years when, I believe it was a Xerox PARC researcher named Mark Weiser, came up with the idea of ubiquitous computing. And in that vision, sort of, it was the notion that instead of the old school vision we have of the Matrix, where you project your consciousness into the computer, as William Gibson and Keanu Reeves has this, eventually we would be embedding computers into the fabric of everyday life, into our clothing, into our buildings, everything else. And since then, the notion of smarter cities has gone through various names, various iterations. I think some of the most latest are the notion of the Internet of Things, where everyday objects will have sort of data attached to them and sort of sensors, and you can sort of trace their lifespans. Or augmented reality, which in its current form, you sort of walk around with your iPhone and you can sort of see data projected onto the real world. These are all sort of early versions of smarter cities that we're seeing. And for a long time, that sort of notion of a smarter city languished. It was sort of seen as a sort of retro-futuristic, dead Jetsonian vision. You know the type if you've ever seen sort of places where you have robotic refrigerators and refrigerators that talk to the internet and replenish the milk when it's gone. And technology companies for a long time have tried to resuscitate it. Microsoft famously has a home of the future, which it rolls out, I think, every year or so, every couple of years, trying to sell us on the notion that all of our gadgets will talk to each other in the future. And it's always sort of failed. It's never caught on despite repeated attempts by these large companies. And if you ask them, they'll tell you it's because the technology wasn't ready yet. And if you ask consumers, they'll say something along the lines of, I don't see the point in having an internet-enabled refrigerator. Well, in the last couple of years, the notion of smarter cities has come back with a vengeance, thanks to large part to IBM and its Smarter Planet campaign. And if you've watched a football game or opened a magazine in the last 2 years, you've seen elements of this campaign. And this time around, smarter cities is defined as a new definition. It's this vision that with falling computer prices and as chips get smaller, it'll be affordable enough to thread billions of transistors, trillions probably, around the world in our clothes, in our buildings, everything else. And they'll generate data, which will be wirelessly collected and will be harvested and put on ever more powerful computers. And those will be run analytical engines. And in the end, what you end up with is something like the SimCity game we actually saw earlier in the Netherlands, which will be sort of a living dashboard that you can sort of tweak your city. And as an aside, I can't believe that I don't think Will Wright ever imagined that SimCity would sort of be the defining interface to cities for its time, but it's really captured people's visions in that regard. And the point of doing this is that you could basically see how a city functioned. You would have sort of a real-time report card on traffic and water and power. And why would you need this? Because you could use it to basically sort of turn the lights off when no one's using them and turn down the thermostat. And what's the point of that? Well, in its boring level, it's costs. You could sell it to someone as you're saving money if you do that. But you can't really capture the imagination of governments or their voters if you just sell it as that it's cheaper. You need a grander narrative. You need to be able to save the world. And that, in this case, that rationale is climate change. It's sustainability. We can use energy efficiency to halt the effects of climate change. That's what people are willing to invest in, and that's what this campaign is for. But perhaps IBM's interest in a smarter planet has less to do with saving the world, ultimately, than it does with reaching governments, because as Willie Sutton once said about banks, that's where the money is. Since the recession 2 years ago, IBM's revenues have been mostly flat, and its fastest growing growth categories are governments, emerging market sales, and business analytics, all three of which are embedded in Smarter Planet campaign. And it should be no surprise that, you know, its success in sort of mining this has spawned copycats. One is Hewlett-Packard's Sense, Central Nervous System for the Earth, which uses sort of the same story and same rationale. And the irony of it is their first customer for this sort of sensor he's holding there is Shell Oil, which intends to use their technology to help it drill for new oil onshore. So you can sort of see that there's cracks in the narrative that are going here. And others have gotten into this. Google, Silver Spring are building smart grids. Autodesk is actually creating SimCity-like interfaces, all of which are bound the notion of smarter cities. But perhaps the most interesting case, I think, is Cisco, which is traditionally the internet's plumber. They make the routers and switches that through which data flows. And as it's grown bigger and bigger, it's now something like a $35 billion company, Cisco is on the lookout for anything which will dump more and more data onto the internet. So it's invested heavily in video and video conferencing. You've probably seen ads for its telepresence, which is as good as it's cracked up to be in terms of making you feel like the other person is there. But the promise of an Internet of Things and of smarter cities promises torrents of data. So they're very much strongly looking into this. And what's interesting is that, you know, a few years ago, Cisco had never had a consumer product. They bought the flip camera, which you might have seen. But now they want to get into the business of building cities, and it is. Cisco signed more than a dozen deals worldwide to actually help build smarter cities from scratch. This photo was taken at the signing for Saudi Arabia's six economic cities. It's building from scratch around the country. The first one is a King Abdullah Economic City near Kaus, their new university. The man who's smiling in the back is John Chambers, who's Cisco's CEO, who told me a year ago at the Clinton Global Initiative that, you know, we were a plumber, and plumber's an honorable profession, but we want to use the technology we have now that has the power to change societies. And that, in this case, is actually what the briefing inquires. The economic cities have been cast as an effort in sustainability to build greener cities in the desert, but really part of the deal is that Saudi Arabia has 10 million people under the age of 17 who are functionally illiterate and have no job prospects. And so Cisco has been explicitly signed on board to help create a Saudi Silicon Valley, a Silicon Wadi, if you will. And that's sort of, you know, a brief that once again goes beyond simple sustainability. The seated man in front is Wim Elfrink, who's Cisco's point man. He's their chief globalization officer. He's the one who's really gotten into the whole smarter cities thing, and is one in charge of signing its deals in India, Western China, the Saudi Arabian, the Persian Gulf, and Portugal, and in Korea. And this is the one I want to talk about first. I have three sort of smarter cities that we're discussing today. This is New Songdo. The years denote its years of construction, not its lifespan. New Songdo is the most expensive privately developed building project in history. It has a price tag, I think, somewhere between $35 and $40 billion right now. It is the size of downtown Boston. It is as dense as Manhattan. And it's rising on a reclaimed mudflat off the coast of Korea, south of the Seoul Incheon Airport, which is connected in that bridge you see in the background that's 12 kilometers long that costs $1 billion on its own. Now, seen through one lens, New Songdo is one of the greenest cities in the world. The entire urban development you see there is LEED certified. It's being built with super energy efficient materials because it's being built from scratch, so you can sort of use the best of anything you like. It's got the best of new materials from 3M, new technologies from United Technologies. It's going to be reclaiming its wastewater. It's going to be burning its solid waste safely for electricity, all of which sort of leads to, sorry, there's a few more slides of it. This is almost taken a year ago. That's at Central Park that's coming in, the tallest tower in Korea, view of some of the landscape. But this is the sort of projected savings that they hope to do through its actual sustainability measures, which is basically a third of the carbon emissions of a similar city its size. New Songdo, as I've mentioned in my book and many others have mentioned it, is a potential prototype for how you build a greener city. Now, on top of this, Cisco has been brought in to start applying sensors to buildings, telepresence screens in every apartment, a whole control room for the master city to sort of guide traffic and water use. And in the process, it'll sell you services at home, like, you know, if you want to book a tea time at the Jack Nicklaus Design Golf Course that's on site, or participate in a class at the international school, all these sorts of things it can sell to you. One service they seriously suggested by the chief globalization officer is that your toilet might analyze the contents of your daily constitutional and offer nutritional advice. So, you know, they're thinking ahead. And, of course, it will sell you these services as sort of a prepackaged thing. Now, that's the sort of future they envision for this. But, you know, if you'd like to see where their vision of a smarter city can go wrong, or see where it had gone wrong in the first place, you can walk a block from the tower over to this building, which is known as Tomorrow City. And upstairs, sort of kept out of sight by the developers, because they don't actually own this, it's owned by the city of Incheon, is sort of a monument, a graveyard of sort of the failed smart city prototypes of yesterday, built by LG, one of Korea's largest conglomerates. And it's exactly the sort of things that we sort of discarded 15 years ago, sort of bad interactive television and sort of virtual closets that pick out objects for you to wear, things that, you know, as visitors from America would sort of look at and be like, this is totally not how it worked out in the end. Why were you guys trying to bring this along? And it didn't work out here either. And I think this sort of speaks to, there's a flip side to the story of Songdo, which I'd like to get into now, beyond being a purely green city of tomorrow and a potential prototype. New Songdo was never designed to be a green city. New Songdo's roots lie in the Asian financial crisis of 1997-1998, when basically Korea needed a $58 billion bailout from the IMF, and the IMF said, sure, but there are conditions. And those conditions included opening up the country to foreign direct investment, which had never done a great job at. So the Koreans decided, well, the easiest way to do that is to actually sort of build a city for foreigners. And so New Songdo is not a Korean city. It is a Western city floating off the coast of Korea, designed for multinationals who will set up its offices there and bring in its people. And sort of, it's a spirit catcher. It's designed to capture the money and knowledge of these sort of Western companies. And the green aspects to it were added effectively in 2006, 5 years after it was planned and after construction already began. And why? As the developers would tell you, they were having difficulty attracting multinationals, and sustainability had become such a powerful narrative, they sort of incorporated the elements because they could, they had this template, but basically it was a selling proposition. Now, it's also always meant to be a smart city, a U-city, as the Koreans call it, ubiquitous city. But, you know, but the roots of that go beyond go back before the sort of sustainability narrative popped up in 2006. The Koreans have been trying to build ubiquitous cities since 1998, 1999, when they were looking for a future for their own sort of Silicon Valley. Again, it was not rooted in sustainability. Their smart cities were meant to be sort of an economic weapon against the Chinese and against anyone else. So again, the issues go beyond it. What's changed is the narrative. And again, these two trends, the narrative of sustainability is this powerful narrative, and the spirit catching of Western money and expertise are what animates the most ambitious sort of eco-city to date, Masdar, out in the desert of Abu Dhabi. Unlike Songdo, Masdar is a green city with smart city elements. Songdo is sort of the other way around. But in terms of cynicism, since it was one of the talks in there, it's really sort of hard to outdo Masdar. This zero carbon city designed by Lord Norman Foster, is 20 miles outside of Abu Dhabi, reachable only by car, even though only combustion vehicles are forbidden within. This sort of city was being built by the world's highest per capita energy usage country in the world, the country with the seventh largest oil reserves. And it's basically at the center of it is MIST, which is this, the Masdar Institute of Science and Technology, which is a science park designed to attract GE and a whole raft of other blue chip multinationals to put in its researchers to basically, again, sort of capture Western expertise and sort of build a technology institute off of, which it can then sell those technologies to other countries. It's about economics. It's ultimately not about sustainability. And this, this sort of ties into the fact that, this is also, we're talking about a country here whose other highlights merge is a Ferrari theme park that's under construction, and a Formula One racetrack with a mega yacht marina in the middle of it. And so it's hard to imagine that they've suddenly developed a massive ecological consciousness. It's hard to overlook the cynicism there. But Masdar embodies yet another trend, seen in smart cities around the world, which is the notion that the city itself is the experiment and that the residents are the people who are experimenting upon themselves. They are the researchers and they're the test subjects. And this is sort of seen as a good thing. You're sort of part of an ecological elite. But it also raises unsettling issues. The New York Times, in a sort of cover story review of Masdar, raised them last week in asking the question whether it ever could be a real city with sort of organic urbanism involved. It's sort of interesting. Another trait that Songdo and Masdar share is that they are effectively walled cities when it comes to sustainability. Masdar, quite literally, there's a wall around it. Songdo, figuratively, its ecological technologies and smart cityness ends at the property line. If you read about Songdo, you get the idea that it's being built in this virgin mud flat and there's nothing around it for miles. But when you go to it, you can see that developers have literally built up to the property line in anticipation of what's to come. And so basically sort of sprawl is sort of surrounded on all sides. It sort of speaks to perhaps the futility of trying to build the sort of perfect ecological city. Cisco has since signed deals with Incheon, the city that owns Songdo, to try to expand it from there. But for now, it's sort of isolated. And I want to stop for just a second here to make a point about cynicism, which is sort of the core of my speech. I don't believe, and I've never come across reporting, and I've never spoken to anyone, and I've never had any reason to believe that the developers of cities such as these, maybe with the exception of Masdar, and companies like Cisco and IBM, believe that they'll fail or believe that this isn't good for the planet. They do believe that smart cities can be good for fighting climate change, and there are plenty of case studies to show this. It's just that they think they can make a lot of money while doing it. But there's something, the greater complication, I think, involved in this is that when you basically do, as Jimmy Carter once said, 30 years ago, that climate change, peak oil, they're sort of entwined, is the moral equivalent of war. Well, when you really start to believe that as a society, the moral equivalent of war gives way to the moral equivalent of a military-industrial complex, companies that sort of rise up to take advantage of this and start applying their own logic and their own narrative on this. And in this case, it's technology companies who believe they hold the keys to this. And so the implication, and what happens over time, is you invite them to take a seat at the table in plotting urbanism, and they begin trying to adapt or think of cities as software. They try to make urbanism in cities behave like software, to make them faster, more efficient, perfectly replicable, and increasing returns to scale. They want to build the perfect sustainable city, and they want to be able to roll it out faster and faster on a global scale. And you can see this logic, the perfect example really, is in my next example, which is Planet Valley, which is the creation of a startup called Living Planet, which was founded by a former Microsoft exec. Now, Living Planet's ideas are twofold. One, they want to overhaul the global construction industry, which is incredibly wasteful and sort of handcraft, and they basically want to make it more like just-in-time lean manufacturing, like Toyota or like Boeing or any of those. But the more ambitious piece, even, is their sort of core piece of code, an urban operating system, a sort of core piece of software that will tie it all together. They'll own it. They will own it, and they will create a sort of model where they'll invite in partners, software companies, including Cisco, which is a participant in this, and management companies, things like that, who will create their own apps to run water, power, traffic, and sell you things. And so essentially what you end up with in their model is a city that behaves a lot like your iPhone, in which case royalties are being paid to them because they own the platform, they own the operating system, and governments will be paying them as well. You know, the example of that, or their test subject, is Planet Valley. This is an example of sort of their whole business model. And, you know, being built right now outside of Portugal is their test case, Planet Valley, which is, you know, it's expected when it's complete, we'll have a population of 150,000 people. It's being built on the hillsides outside Porto. Almost all of the residents they conceive will be employees of themselves or of their partners. It's a company town, effectively. And they'll all be working on the innovations they hope to export to cities that are being built from scratch in China, India, and so on. And so once again, the city itself is the experiment. And as they conceive it, it's a city that lives in the cloud. It's essentially, they imagine decommissioning buildings like you decommission a server. Their IT would define the urbanism. And while the impetus, of course, to build these cities, they're very well versed, the founders of this, and sort of the issues that have come up before, the challenge of urbanization, mass migration, sustainability, all of that, it has not escaped their attention that it will do wonders for your property values and for the net worth of your undeveloped land. So while it's an open question that any of Living Planet cities get built, it is a startup after all, Cisco is pursuing almost a similar model. It's imagining software stacks and cloud computing managing its cities. You know, and Songdo's developers themselves, Gale International is the name of the company, they're based here in Manhattan, and KPF, Cohen Peterson Fox, the architects, they're seeing it the same way. Right now, KPF's architects are trying to reverse engineer the thousands and thousands of decisions and process steps that went into designing and building new Songdo. They want to figure out the formula for how they arrived at a city built from scratch. And Songdo is actually a nice city. It is an amalgam of the best Western cities, which sounds like Dubai when you hear it described, like the best of Paris, Savannah, New York. But basically it means they took the grid of New York and the pocket parks of Savannah, and they've sort of layered in a complex urbanism that doesn't try to do too much. But now they're trying to basically sort of learn from that process so they can speed it up. Stan Gale wants to build not another new city, he wants to build 20 new cities across China. And he wants to build the next one in 7.5 years, not 15. And he wants to build the one after that in 5 years. And eventually he thinks he can get down the infrastructure to 36 months. And he can do this because he's brought in Cisco to help him automate it, and his architects, and the same consortium to sort of build these cities across China. And so again, it's the logic of software, Moore's law. Everything's going to move faster, it's going to get cheaper every 18 months, and we can sort of accelerate urbanism to the pace of the technology that's going to save us all. The first sequel to Songdo was going to be built outside Changsha in western China. It was Meiji Lake. The lake, in fact, was fake. They were going to flood it and replace it. I think it had been a lake at one time. But that project has been effectively canceled due to the vagaries of the Chinese real estate market and Chinese politics. I think they effectively asked for too much in dealing with them. But they're trying again. At the moment, they're about to submit a proposal to the government of Chongqing, which is the fastest growing city on Earth. Foreign Policy just wrote a great piece about this. Chongqing is technically a municipality of 32 million people spread across the size of New Jersey. But the urban core is about 6 million people, and it's growing at 300,000 people a year, which is the equivalent of bolting on Pittsburgh to your city year after year after year. So they're going to basically try to build the gleaming portion of it, the smart city that stands as an example to that. You know, will it succeed? Quite possible they could actually get it built. So to sort of sum up, the notion of crusade or cynicism is the title of this talk. I mean, in some sense, the answer is both. I mean, the creators of these cities and the technologists do believe this is an actual weapon they can be using against climate change. But the question I think that we have to ask as voters, as citizens in there, is basically sort of who controls the data that they're going to generate from this. And there's already been debates that have come out of this about, you know, of cities basically selling off their citizens' aggregate data to corporations. And also sort of basically sort of, you know, forcing our cities to develop in the sort of logic and scale of software, of how quickly we can build these. I don't know, there's interesting implications, and I don't have any answers to that, but it is fascinating that the notion of a smarter city is basically to think of a city in terms of, not in terms of traditional urbanism, the Jane Jacobs approach of building a functional city for people, but building really a sort of functional city that you can then roll out endlessly and perfect it as you go. So thank you very much. That's my book coming out. Reach me there. Thank you.
Well, while this is loading, just a few words of introduction. It was Buckminster Fuller who said, think global, act local, and it's one of the things I'll make reference to in some of the projects I want to show. And so I'll start with a bit of a global perspective, leading to the relevance of the built environment on different scales. And there's certainly a lot to be said about the contribution of the built environment to our climate problems. I think that's pretty much established at this point. And I really want to focus on energy and how wind integration or the use of natural resources can help us to probably help to solve these problems. And so I'd like to just start off with this. And this is from the National Geographic's milestone in our history in 2008 with half the human population living in urban centers. So obviously, there is various effects that come with that. And if we now look at the energy consumption by sector in the last set of decades from 50 to 10, we see a significant contribution of the building sector, which is considered in the developed world to take about 50% of our energy consumption. And then we have about a quarter from the industry, about a quarter from transportation. If you look at this from an architectural standpoint, we're also involved in designing transportation by being part of the urban planning. We certainly draw from the industry by specifying products, materials, all the things we use in our buildings. So it's not quite clear where we are. And it certainly isn't quite clear what it means to consume energy because there's many forms of energy. So if we look at the world electricity generation, I'd just like to speak about that and focus on this for a second. By fuel, we certainly see a massive increase according to our use, and we have various energy resources to make that happen. Now, if we look at electricity generation related to CO2 emissions from fossil fuel sources, we see a significant contribution primarily based on coal combustion, which is here in the US, the leading source for the generation of electricity. Now, what has that to do with buildings? Well, it has a lot to do with buildings, because if we look at the, and I apologize, some notes went missing here. I think there were font issues. This is basically by the American Information Agency for Energy and the DOE. And you see the relevance of the building factor with having a 76% share in this. So obviously, we as architects participate in this discussion to a large degree. Talking about different scales, I'd like to briefly touch on the reaction that we see if we propose the use of these kinds of technologies, which is wind turbines in particular, large-scale turbines. And this is a project that touches on various scales and has a lot to do not only with the city, but how we participate as consumers within a community. And so this is the proposal, and you probably heard the news a couple of months ago that it's going ahead, the design for the first offshore wind farm in the US. In Cape Cod. And this is the proposal that was just signed off on. And the Boston Society of Architects, in response to a huge amount of protest, was challenging this and was questioning designers from all over the world to answer the question, how do we deal with this? Right? And it's not just a socio-economical problem because certain people on their private beaches really don't like this view. It's also, you know, ordinary people, not only heavy industrials that have the money and the lawyers to defend this, but it's pretty much everybody in the community that is producing this, right? The goal is to generate 70-75% of clean and renewable energy for the community. This is what they get. So the question is, what do you do with that? The BSA asks us to make this a different experience, right? Could be a water park, could be educational, could be fantastic as an environment to learn to live with this. And we won that competition by basically saying, guess what, it's not good enough. We need to do something very different here. And we basically redesigned the entire brief in three distinct steps. So the first was just look at what we have. Why do we need all this in the first place? Then we started to redefine the parameters by looking at various studies that were done in Germany and Denmark on community upgrades and how we could use contemporary technologies to minimize energy consumption. Then we looked at more efficient technologies for the use in exchange, the wind turbine types, according to what was available then. And then we said, this is really not just a local political problem, this is a national problem. And obviously, if the states as a whole don't change their attitudes, then that is a bit of a problem too. So can we do something to bring this to a national level? And I don't really want to go into too much detail, but the point on the studies that we found was that we find a lot of household equipment from the 60s, 70s, 80s, and compared to contemporary devices, those are just not very efficient. So upgrading an average community could significantly help to change the way that community consumes. And that would really attach to every single household and the individual that lives there, leading to potentially average 50-52% savings in energy consumption and then respectively CO2 emissions. So then exchanging the turbines to a more powerful device, that helped us to further reduce the required turbines. And summing up, we found that we can really significantly reduce energy consumption and then respectively the turbines that are needed to generate the electricity for that community, ending up with 50. Now that's obviously a very beautiful number when you think of the national scale. And so the next step was then in designing this wind farm to say, can we do this in a way that people take pride in participating in this rather than being fearful and rejective? And this is the plan of this wind farm. And you see it here from the air, obviously much more compact. And it's starting to be what we call the energy island. So rather than seeing this as a power plant that no one really likes, we wanted this to make an exciting environment for people to go to. The next step then, looking at the turbines, was to understand these structures are incredibly elaborate. They take incredible wind loads, and can we do something to generate the park with minimal means and by basically reducing embodied energy consumption by adding very, very little to the elaborate structures there already. And this is what we added. It's a very spiderweb-like delicate suspension system that works structurally in a way that it also represents the political power behind this. It's a very delicate system in many ways, but it essentially means that if one of the turbines representing one of the states doesn't hold up, doesn't contribute, doesn't exist, then the whole system becomes weak and eventually fails. So it's a structural interpretation of a political idea. Now, then we said in this wind park, we would like to have every state to participate on what we call the deck section, which is essentially an outside pavilion where they could talk about their initiatives that could change throughout the seasons, could make it a very exciting environment that is ever changing. And then obviously, it would be also a pretty embarrassing spot to have a blank pavilion because you're not doing anything. Now, this is Maine. They're doing pretty good, so we picked them here. So this is the idea where you would really have some sort of expo arrangement representing these different states and just giving you a bit of an idea where we envisioned this to be what we call the E50 arena, which is an environment for sports activities, all sorts of cultural activities. There could be sports competitions, there could be concerts, all sorts of cultural events. Because one of the biggest fears there are is to threaten the tourism in the state, which is one of the major sources of income in the community. So then we started to add buildings that would house all the required functions, technological functions, programmatic functions, so there could be cafes, exhibition spaces, there could be all the technical equipment that would negotiate that ring park. As you see here as a diagram, with that suspended portion, and the building would negotiate with the water level that would also allow for water access and activities on these different levels. And this is what it would look like from the water. And then we added more functions to the second building, where we said, isn't it a nice opportunity to allow for different forms of access, but to also allow for different programmatic needs to be accommodated for, and eventually bring people from the community so they could really learn to live with these kinds of technologies. This is what we call the multipurpose piazza. It could house all sorts of different events, hopefully celebrating the reduced amount of turbines and the increased efficiency in the community. And then also bring in people of different ages. Looking at this addition, which would be a platform for public use, for instance, diving schools, surfing schools, etc. So again, bringing the community into this, or making it a public pool during the summer. So this is what we started with, 130 large-scale turbines, basically placed entirely on engineering and financial concerns, and this is what we ended up with. And really starting to address the community, the city environment behind this. So this is a comparison between an animation that Cape Wind is still putting forward, and this is the comparison. So the wind farm, much more remote from the coast, much more a destination point, and then certainly a very different programmatic idea behind all this. And we were hoping that that would be appreciated by all inhabitants of the bay. So that little guy there. And so again, this is what we started with, and this is what we ended up with. So that's looking at the community engagement related to these technologies and how, you know, you can really engage every single one in understanding that, you know, whatever we do, it has consequences, and sometimes we don't like them. Going into research, I'd like to very briefly introduce a couple of projects, and this is really more to be seen as a string of thoughts. It's impossible to explain all this in a few minutes, but so I'll just touch on a couple of things. One is that we really need, and most of the people that have spoken already represent that also, an interdisciplinary working mode. And I'm collaborating with an aerospace engineer. Now, that is not a typically common combination of disciplines, but we're having a really great time in learning from another how we can make buildings more efficient, or for him to learn about buildings at all. And this is a project that we're still involved with that is doing a couple of things for us. And what we're trying to understand is, if we look at buildings, how can we start to manipulate an airflow around the building for various reasons? And I just want to show the principles behind this. Typically, we live with certain wind loads, for instance. We design the structure accordingly. Here we go. What we started to do is set up an experiment. You see the base configuration on the top left, where we assume a certain wind direction. We've chosen elliptical footprint to understand pretty distinct pressure differentials around the building. And then we actuated what we call flow resistance devices. This could be wind turbines, screens, all sorts of other things. And we started to see that we can start to manipulate the airflow around the building. So we could literally flip the profile. So the building would interact with the environment in a very different way. And then initiating a turbine on the other side, seeing an increase, and who's not used to this, this is what's called CFD plots, computer fluid dynamics. It's a simulation process where you can simulate airflow, pressure, velocity, etc. And you know, there's low pressure, it's blue, and red is high pressure. And you see, when we activate two of those, a lot of those conditions change very drastically. So then going into what we do as architects, speculative, but designing a typical plan, and then backing off a little and diagramming this in a way that we could understand the science behind it. So this is what happens in terms of red, what we call exfiltration. It's leaving air or building. Sorry, air leaving the building versus infiltration, the blue ones, which is pushing air into the building. This has to do with natural ventilation. We're still kind of fighting for projects here in the US to really acknowledge that that works. It's it's a little odd. But it's typically, you know, like here we are in the space and it's actually a little cold. And it's a little odd that we have all these advanced technologies. We're thinking of entire smart cities, yet we still have to get the grip on controlling environments and buildings. So if we look at this, you can start to see what happens. We can control enhanced natural ventilation for this high rise, which is fairly unusual. We can also think of then amending established typologies, not only in the building structure, but for instance in redesigning facade components, which if you want to do that are typically double layered, excessive use of materials, very expensive too. We can understand the impact on natural ventilation modes. We can understand the impact on reduced stress loads in the structure, which also helps to save materials. And we understand the different means of controlling the environment outside and inside the building. Obviously, we have a lot of existing buildings, and the question is, we're not going to design all of them because they will be sticking around for a while. So is there anything we can do to make use of these structures? And so what we're trying to do is understand, A, how does the building participate? What kind of conditions do we find? And this is from colleagues in Melbourne that looked at these kinds of buildings in a computer fluid dynamic environment, and they find these hotspots. Makes a lot of sense. The air accumulates in front of the building and it shoots around the corners. And that's exactly where I'm trying to interfere with these wings, as I call them. So you see the green arrow, and what happens is you've got these two fascias that would help to compress the air and increase the capacity of the turbine. I'll show you another example in a second. Now, the urban environment is highly unpredictable. You have a lot of turbulences and you don't quite understand what you can do. So that is a challenge, and I'll show you a model. And then this is one of the Syracuse University program buildings that we occupy, where we're working on a proposal to hopefully implement this. This is really a project that's exciting me most because we are in the middle of realizing this. It's a self-sustaining streetlight. The idea is to develop a streetlight that works entirely off the energy grid, that can be planted like a tree, and that is entirely self-supporting. Combines vertical axis wind turbine, low energy LEDs, and PV. And so we're really trying to get this to the point of commercialization, and we're pretty much there. This is a couple of preliminary sketches where you see the top and the lower right shows the principle. It's basically about compressing air in a way that it increases velocity and pressure towards the center of this, and that preliminary sketch there shows where the turbine is located. And thinking about how that could be multiplied according to the consumption. So it goes back to the ideas of the wind farm. Generate as much as you need, not necessarily more. And this is another CFD plot showing how that principle works. Again, you see a significant increase going up to the highest scale. That provides increased velocity and pressure in the center. That's where the turbine is. And we see an increase of that efficiency up to 300%. It also helps to reduce the startup time of the turbine, which means that it kicks in much earlier with low winds. Then we obviously need to find means of storing that energy that we generate during the day to then consume it at night. And hopefully, if there is a surplus in urban areas, to then feed into the grid if we can. So we've been through various steps, looking at all these different components and developing them to the degree that we can really start the prototyping now. We're looking at wind canal testing at one of our research partners at Clarkson University. And we're moving into the digital fabrication where we translate computer fluid dynamic optimization processes in design models that then help us to really develop the product. This is some engineering studies for the geometry optimization, so the relation of casework and turbine. Going back into the design process, and this is the design as it currently stands that we are now working towards commercialization. Building the prototype, and this is it. I just wanted to show a 30-second sequence, and then I'm going to be wrapping up. Could you start that, or should I start it that from here?
Well, I'm green here.
Holy, oh, I'm recording.
Well, I hope it doesn't work.
What?
Well, I'm green here.
Holy, oh, I'm recording.
Well, I'm green here.
Holy, oh, I'm recording.
Well, I hope it doesn't
what?
Work.
What?
Yeah, it's green.
Yeah. We got power?
We got power.
Excited about it works.
So we're really at a point where we have the confirmation and now take this a step further. And I want to close with two things. One is showing how this could be implemented in a certainly rural environment, but we're working with an industry partner that's working, and we have the patent on this, but they are working with the provisional patent on a turbine that works with turbulent flow in an environment like a city where you have a lot of different conditions at different times. So that would hopefully allow us to really bring this onto the city environment as well. Just two quick things in terms of architecture. Can we now use this? And the intention was from the start to test something on a fairly small scale to then bring it into the building environment. And this is the design for a residence, what I call the turbine house. And that would work really with the same kind of principles. And so that would then determine the design of the entire structure. You see how that's implemented into the top of the building. You've got a big pergola, which is using solar heat exchangers and PV panels to run the building as much as the turbine does for the energy supply. Typical section of the middle piece. And understanding that we want to get, we don't want to mimic, I totally agree that we can't mimic, but we can learn from nature, certainly. And then the question, can we make environmentally efficient architecture more desirable? Or can we find new typologies that really reflect the technical innovation that's inherently in there? And then finishing with the flux tower, which again is an idea to translate the early ideas of multiplying the effects into high-rise structures. Learning from controlling airflow around the building is what I call the energy shield, which would help to protect the actual skin where it reflects. Understanding the performance impact of significantly reduced suction on the back of the building, which is as significant as the pushes you get in the front. Going through an optimization process to design this building. And then understanding the very different design that comes out of that process compared to conventional building typologies. So then multiplying that effect that you saw in the sectional diagram, the diagram in the middle, and take this also in the plan, so you've got decentralized cores that help to also direct the airflow to the center where the turbines are located. Thinking of modules in terms of an optimized construction and evaluation process. And then again, understanding this in an urban context and the difference to conventional building typologies. Thank you very much.
Well, Saskia put me into this session, and I feel like a spoiler.
We need that ending.
But sometimes it's good to bring you back to some sort of sense of reality. I love what I saw. And Greg Lindsay, in particular, made it easy for me to be set up. I will have some comments. I want to start with two assertions and say that, one, despite great strides to understand the Earth's natural processing, managing the growth of cities, whether rich or poor, has become utterly divorced from recognizing the great destructive power of normal extreme events that are an integral part of the Earth's inner workings. This, in my mind, is the expression of a clash of two things. The time horizons, human time horizon versus, let's call it geological time horizons. And two, the objectives of man to seek concentration of power. And cities the best symbol of concentration of power. While nature, on the other hand, seeks dispersive entropy. It wants to equalize things, erode mountains, whatever. And two, the growth of cities proceeds largely in denial of man-made accelerated climate change, especially of hastened sea level rise. And this denial puts many coastal cities at an advanced risk and dooming some to become unsustainable. Well, sometimes we can learn from history, even so we rarely seem to do it. But before I go there, let me first outline what I think are some of the consequences from those two premises. Natural disasters involving major cities are on a steep rise because there are many more, ever larger, and more vulnerable cities in often precarious locations. And two, in this century, there is a finite chance that a single natural disaster will cause more than a million fatalities or losses in excess of $1 trillion. And I say or, because the fatalities will occur, of course, in the poor developing cities, and the trillions will be in the developed cities. And both are at risk, but not necessarily from the same event. Learning from history. I'm asking, where is Alexandria? So let's take a plunge into history. Here it is. This is Cleopatra's palace, Temple of Isis, submerged in 30 feet of water. And if you can read it on the upper right, the submergent rate is about 5 millimeters per year. That's less than half the thickness of my finger every year. But it adds up to quite some impact. And so, again, we can't blame Cleopatra for not knowing about that, but there's no excuse today for not knowing it. We have pretty much most of the facts that we need relatively at our fingertips, notwithstanding all the great uncertainties and probabilities that we have talked earlier today. Well, this city is not 2,000 years old, it's a little bit older than 200 years. And we see here the beginning of a similar process. The submergence rate is right now about the same as for Alexandria, which was also a delta, the Nile Delta. This is the Mississippi Delta. And all deltas have the property that they compact the sediments, so they sink naturally for geologic reasons. And in addition, of course, we put sea level rise on top of it. So those two will accelerate in the future while the geological compaction pretty much stays constant. We will accelerate sea level rise. Again, we can't blame the French when they started New Orleans and they were smart enough to put it on the crest of the natural levees that the Mississippi River built on its own. So the old French forts and all that in the old French city are at a relatively safe place. But then cities expand into places where they shouldn't. We have the knowledge now that it shouldn't, but do we use it? Well, back home, What does this mean here in New York? As part of the mayor's effort to look at climate change, we had an NPCC as analogy to the IPCC, not the international, but the New York panel on climate change. And we were charged to look at what happens to New York City. Well, you see here three colors, red, yellow, and green. And the legend tells you that this is the extent of the so-called 100-year flood, or 1% annually probability, how it will extend with sea level rise, in this case assumed to be 2 and 4 feet, sorry. And, you know, we already have currently a risk exposure for a 100-year storm, but it will get worse with time. Now, New York City, unlike most of New Orleans, has the advantage that many places, including this building, are way above sea level. So we would lose something on the fringes and could retreat and make Manhattan even denser than it is. What's the big problem? Well, the big problem are these colored lines here. And we all know them as the subway system. And the black lines that are other rail commuting systems and Amtrak. And they are city below the city. They are way below the sea level already. So when you race on the fringes, you eventually encroach on all the entrances that are normally supposed to be dry, whether you go into the subway or whether you walk on the pedestrian walk over the grids where you hear the subway rumbling underneath you. And when you flood some of those, we calculate it with hydrodynamic calculations. It takes about 40 to 50 minutes to fill up the subway system. Now, we worked with the MTA to figure out how long it would take to bring the system back. Remember, there's equipment in there that would get submerged into salt water for which no replacements exist. You would have to take it apart, clean it, reassemble. Estimates range from 3 weeks to 2 years, depending on the details, big uncertainty. Well, some people have said, oops, that's not how it goes. This is, for instance, the picture of all the flooded subway tunnels. And remember, they go under the East River here between Manhattan and Brooklyn. So you have to pump out the water. And you can't just suck it out. You have to have submersible pumps and all that sort of thing. So when you get into the nitty-gritty, how you would deal with that, with this problem, you really have a hard time to figure out how to just logistically do it, not to speak of technical details. Now, many people have said, okay, so let's build some barriers. You need at least 3, perhaps 4, because if you don't build this one, this whole part of Brooklyn is still exposed. At strategic points and barrier off the city, is that sustainable? It is my very personal notion that it is not. Essentially, we are setting ourselves up for a situation a la New Orleans, where we build a defense system, it has a finite lifetime, It needs a lot of maintenance. It has to grow with sea level rise. And in the meanwhile, you feel safe behind that system. And then comes the low probability extreme event and wipes you out. And you are totally unprepared for that event behind your supposedly functional defenses. So I'm not excluding the possibility that temporarily we may have some barriers here. You know, there's a model, for instance, where one of the New York engineering firms made a conceptual drawing. They may have a temporary role, but as sea level keeps rising, there's a problem. And the problem is essentially not in New York, it's up in Greenland. And so far we have been dealing with the sea level rise simply from the warming of the oceans, and the water in the oceans expands as it warms. But on top of it, there are curves here that tell you how much feet of globally the sea level will rise if Greenland goes under the influence on certain temperatures at which we believe we can stabilize the atmosphere, plus 2 degrees or plus 3, 5.5, or 8 above the current average level. Depending on that, you have these additional sea level rise curves, and that is just Antarctica. This is just Greenland. There will be Antarctica. We don't, the climate scientists, that is, don't have yet a good handle on what Antarctica will do. So I'm simply saying that if you've built a defense system and you don't have an exit strategy, you are actually in trouble. It's a little bit like declaring war to nature and you have not an exit strategy how to get out of that war. Now, to come back to the global situation. Here we have, as of January of this year, the cities around the world, it's more than 8 million. It's not really cities, it's sort of a mixture of urban agglomeration. However that is defined, you get a different list of who is in and who is out here. But we see, of course, that these are just the cities of which all of them are located on coasts. So they will have to deal with sea level rise, not all the millions in each city, but a subset of their population within each city. And then we have planned cities. Where do we plan them? On the waterfront. As if sea level rise would not exist. Now, I'm not saying they couldn't last 100 years or perhaps 200 years. But are we really planning cities for 100 or 200 years? We have seen this picture before. And Greg reminded us that it's a city on a mudflat. I took from his same paper, his map, where these 9 cities are listed in addition to some door, and I ranked them by the populations for which they are planned, 2 million to 30,000. Okay. And on the right, I put sea level rise, earthquakes, and urban floods and mudslides, just as some of the hazards to which they are exposed to various degrees. Because of time, I will accelerate. This slide shows three income groups and the growth of cities between 1960 and 2000 in each of those three income groups. What we see is the horrendous rise of low-income cities of between 3 and 8 and above 8 million is compared to the relatively stagnant growth in the high-income cities. When we look at another graph between 1950s and 2000, this is now the population that lives in the 50 largest cities in the world, and then a subset, which ones are exposed to earthquake hazards, and within that group, which one are in developing countries. Then we see that the total increase in the population was three times over that period in those cities, 50 largest cities. The earthquake threatened ones is growing by 7 times, and those that are in that yellow part but are in developing countries grew by 10 times. So what this means is we are adding constantly at an excessive rate vulnerable cities. This is a gruesome statistic where earthquake magnitude on the right and the death on the top is being plotted. Here's Haiti, here's Tangshan. This was in 76, officially 240,000 fatalities, unofficially maybe more than 500,000. And we all know Haiti just a few years. So what does this mean in terms of this growth of cities? You can make a plot in which you plot the cumulative number of fatal earthquakes against the fatalities. And you get this gruesome plot, and you see that there are several above 100,000. And it essentially tells you, since we are adding these multi-million population cities to it, it is quite likely that within this 100-year period, this was from 1900 to 97, we will fill out this trend out there with an unpleasant target of 1 to 2 events with 1 million people at one stroke. This is the list of the 25 largest urban agglomerations of this year, again with the hazards in these three patterns. And if you look at them, you know, they are anywhere from 34 million Tokyo, and Tokyo is exposed to all of these various hazards, to Lagos being one of the fastest growing city. And many of them, as we have seen from Mumbai, which would be here, have, of course, real problems not to react just to those possibilities, but to plan in a forward sense. So what can we do? And I hope to wrap this up. But before I give you even a formula, risk, someone mentioned earlier, is the probability times its consequence. Well, that's the probability of the hazard, and that's the consequence. But risk, if you want to take a measure of risk, let's say the loss, the dollar losses, is simply a probability where you sum up over the whole region of interest, let's say all parts of New York City, or all parts of United Arab Emirates. Okay? And locally, you sum up over a product, the hazard times the assets that are exposed to the hazard times the vulnerability of those assets. Now, we can reduce the hazard, for instance, from climate change or sea level rise by mitigation, by not emitting as many greenhouse gases. But there are other ways to reduce the risk. We can have no assets exposed. Well, that's what's happening in the Antarctica, so that's not working very well. We still want to have assets. So when we look now at the combination of hazards and assets, it's a matter of where we place them. That means land use, planning, and zoning, considered placement of new assets, relocation of essential assets, levees and dams with a question mark because their sustainability is not clear. There are the equity issues, who is inside and outside the protected areas, who is on the bad soil and the good one. You can look at another combination, not the assets and hazards, but now we look at the assets and vulnerability. That means good engineering. Means construction quality control, codes and code enforcement, retrofitting, raising assets in place, sometimes reinforcing levees and maybe increasing the capacity of pump station. But the simplest thing would be reducing vulnerability by reducing poverty. That would be the most effective risk reduction. Now, I said the simplest. And we know it's probably the most difficult. Millennium goals, you say. So, to cure or not to cure, or I modify that to cure and how to cure, then that is the question. We have the option to remain oblivious to the processes of nature and let her do her grim education, namely kill and destroy. That is unfortunately, by and large, with some exceptions, the current state of affairs on a global scale, with the most devastating effects in the poorest and least developed nations and cities, whether you go from Port-au-Prince in Haiti to an affluent country and yet a poor city like New Orleans, or at least portions of it. Or we initiate and pursue strengthen a systematic global movement of disaster risk-aware urban planning, growth and renewal towards achieving sustainable urban habitats. And we cannot exclude the basic understanding, scientific understanding, how the Earth works when we go ahead and dream up our cities. There are samples of the past, present, and some in the future. We heard about the Netherlands, and they deal with it in various levels of success. I would not say everything is success there. You have scaled back from your 10 to the minus 4 per year to 10 to the minus 3 per year acceptance as to what losses are. You now plan for the levees to be overflown and deal with that rather than preventing overflow. So there are many ways to go. London has Thames Estuary 2100 project, Hamburg, I will come in a second to it, St. Petersburg. Most of them, like Venice, are essentially walls behind your height, which you hide. I have an example where they don't hide. There's the C40, the 40 cities effort. It was originally largely for mitigating, reducing emissions. I think they gradually come around that adaptation is a necessity. And the C40s are expanding it now, includes places like Jakarta and so on. We have a plan here in New York City, 2030, and the NPCC that got to work. But that's yet on a study level. It's not yet on an implementation level. So we still have to rally the political support and the money to do it. Resetting of priorities. There's the UN Millennium Development Goals, which has a component about disaster risk reduction. The International Strategy for Disaster Reaction, and as a sideline of the Kyoto Show, was the Hyogo Framework, and so on. There are other things listed here. And I'm closing with this example. And the reason I'm closing with it, because it's an effort not hiding behind walls. It's an effort to live with the flood. This is the city of Hamburg, where this part here is protected by levees and dams. But there's the so-called harbor city, which is really an assembly of several hundred-year-old warehouses where you could drive your boats in, unload it, and then roads went out and delivered the goods to the land. This is being redeveloped, but it's being redeveloped with sea level rise in mind. The way they do it right now, it's they set it at 8 meters above the present, which buys them maybe 200 years, and then they will have to deal with it again. Okay? So I'm not saying that this is much better than levees and dams and barriers, but it is a more organic way to adaptively recycle our knowledge, our assets, and do it on a project-by-project basis rather than having an entire community agree at one time on one solution and then defer down the line a similar community decision for 100, 200 years. Certainly, I find this more encouraging and, for instance, more applicable to New York than building barriers. But that, of course, is a discussion in the communities and has to be locally resolved. Mitigation, reducing emissions, is a global goal. Adaptation occurs locally, is a local issue. And with that, thank you very much.
Thank you, everyone. We're going to have a break now, and the next group of speakers will begin at 3:30.